Good morning. It's okay? So I owe many of you some a reference. So it's not working, huh?
No, it's working, but I think maybe it's just the position.
The thing is not.
Try now.
Hello? It's better? No, I don't think so. Maybe there is a volume thing on this one. No, that's it, huh? Everything looks okay. Yeah?
The volume is good.
There is a red button here.
Sorry?
Hello? It doesn't sound right, eh? Hello? Gaat het goed? I should say something, eh? Yeah. So, good morning.
It's definitely working.
But can you understand me? Okay. So let's go. So many of you asked for a reference about how the proof of hyperbolicity of renormalization for circle diffeomorphisms. So let me write it down. It's also on the notes of today, but let me write it down. So reference for hyperbolicity of circle diffeomorphization. And it is by G. Stark. And it has a long title, but what is important? Yeah, you can figure it out. It's really long. It's in nonlinearity. Nonlinearity number one, and that was in 1988, and the pages are from 541 to 575. If you cannot, if this is not enough, then you can just go to the notes of today, day 8, and it will be in the whole title will be in the top, so you should be able to find it. Okay. So we finished the circle diffeomorphisms, and last time, yesterday, we started to renormalize unimodal maps. And what was the situation? We are looking at the space of unimodal maps, which looks something like that, where this is something C3, and where the second derivative in the critical point is non-zero. So there's really some quadratic shape there. So the space of this ones is the space of unimodal maps. But then there are renormalizable ones. And the renormalizable ones have the property that there are two intervals which are being exchanged. And there's an interval U and an interval V, and this is exchanged by F. So if you have a system like this, you call it renormalizable. So and then you see, if you do renormalization, you have to choose the domain where you do your zooming. And we are going to use this interval. And you see the return map is just the second iterate. You take the interval, it goes here, and it comes back. So if you plot the graph of the second iterate, you will see something like here we have U, and here we have V, and it will look something like path. It will look something like that. And then what we do is, we take here, you see again, a little unimodal map upside down. But if you can rescale this in an affine way, and then you see again a unimodal map, and we call that the renormalization of F. Okay? And then yesterday we finished with the main theorem, let me just recall it briefly. So the picture of this renormalization operator is exactly what you expect it to be. So there exists a unique fixed point which has an unstable manifold, which is it's just a curve, a one-dimensional object, and there is also a stable manifold which has codimension 1. So, and what is important is that the eigenvalue here, the expanding eigenvalue, is the number we saw before. That is this number 4.669. I remember yesterday we were looking at parameter universality, and there was this number 4.669 showing up. So this is briefly the statement, but what is important for us is that if you take the stable manifold, this manifold, that is exactly the class of infinitely renormalizable maps. And this is a topological class. Yeah? And so if we go back to our diagram, we had this general picture about renormalization, which explains the bifurcation pattern, which explains the topology, which explains the measure theory, and which explains the geometry. And now you see from this last part of the main theorem that the set of infinite renormalizable maps, which is a topological class, is just a manifold. It's a manifold, a stable manifold of this operator. And so this explains already something about the bifurcation pattern. The topological class of infinite renormalizable maps is a manifold. Okay, so let's say a little bit more about the dynamics of these things. Now maybe I can, you know, let's use this eigenvalue 4.669 and explain where the parameter dependence comes from. And so let's make a picture. Of all our unimodal maps. And these are C3 maps with non-degenerate critical point. And inside there is some strip of the maps which are once renormalizable. So these are the once renormalizable maps. And now the picture of renormalization, which is it's really sitting here on an infinitesimal the picture. So what the renormalization does, it takes this set of renormalizable maps and it maps it to something like that. And so you start roughly, so you start to see an hyperbolic picture. And then somewhere inside here, we have our fixed point. And somewhere here, we have our unstable manifold, and somewhere here we have our stable manifold. And we notice that the derivative of renormalization in the fixed point has an eigendirection, and the eigenvalue is this number 4.669. And let's see how that number shows up in this parameter universality picture. So let's recall what was going on. And remember, if you take your family, if you take a family of unimodal maps, then you can create chaos, which we discussed yesterday, and it goes according to appear doubling. Cascade. And so it was something like this. First, your dynamics is controlled by an attracting fixed point. Then at some moment, you get appeared 2 point, and then a little later, you get appeared 4 point. So, and it continues like this, and then there will be an infinity value where the chaos begins. And then yesterday we discussed that these bifurcation moments where the period doubling happens converges to this boundary of chaos, and it converges exponentially fast, and the rate is 1 over 4.669. And so, and now let's use this picture to explain this parameter universality. And you probably you see already how it goes. Let's do it with a little color. Orange. Red. And so, let's... This is our family here, and this family, I don't know where it is, but it is maybe sitting somewhere here, some curve. And now, we see that this strip are the once renormalizable maps, but then there will be a thinner strip where you have maps which are twice renormalizable. And then there will be, and then where the family enters this strip, is, you have to check that, is exactly this moment. So this corresponds to the moment T1. But then there will be a thinner strip where the maps are 3 times renormalizable. And where the family enters this third strip, it will be T2. And now you see the picture happening. Each time you go, if you have more renormalizations, you get exactly these intersections converging to T infinity, which is the intersection of this stable manifold. Yeah, that's part of the theorem. That is, and this picture is easy to draw. It's just a hyperbolic picture, but to prove this is a big story. That is part of this theory. This. Okay. But now you see, you know, if you have a saddle point in hyperbolic saddle point, then you know that these pre-images, they accumulate everywhere at the stable manifold with the eigenvalue of the fixed point. And that is just, you know, from saddle points. So here you see explained why these bifurcation moments converge with the eigenvalue 4.6. Okay, so now I think this really explains the bifurcation picture. And this is sort of where the history began. This 4.6 was the first thing they observed, that Tresser and Coulet and Feigenbaum. And so this is historically the beginning point. Okay, so but now let's go on to the rest of the dynamics. Zero.
Is zero. Zero, yeah. And is it conjugated to something in the, let's say, logistic family or something like that?
Yeah. And so you might think that this curve is the logistic family. Yeah. And here you have the infinite renormalizable map in the...
The
accumulation of period doubling. And now we saw part of the theorem, that the stable manifold is exactly the topological class. So indeed, these maps are conjugated. And yeah. And so this is like the third part. Okay?
So you were saying that at some point you would describe the actual fixed point. There's some information we have about the fixed point.
Yeah.
The geometry of the fixed point.
Yeah. I will give you some. So this fixed point is a complicated object. You cannot write down a formula. It is some analytic function. And it is something, don't even try to write down a formula. And hopefully today I can show you why it is something complicated. And you cannot make this by hand. Okay, so remember when we did the circle renormalization, we had towers. And we built a whole dynamical picture out of these towers. So let's see what are the towers for our pair doubling renormalization. Now, how was it again? So we start with this interval, say U1, which goes here and comes back under two iterates. But then this map is again renormalizable, so inside here, you will again find two intervals, which are exchanged by the second iterate. And so, and let's say this is interval U2, and that will be returning by f to the 2 times f to the 2 is f to the 4th. And then inside here, there will be another interval, which will be exchanged, and it will be interval U3, and that will be returning into itself by f to the 8th. And so there are these intervals, un, they are shrinking down. That's a little theorem. And they return by powers of the time, return times of 2 to the n. So you see that the tower, from this, you get the tower. And the tower is extremely simple. So here you have, so here we have a picture of the nth renormalization, like what we did in the circles. And you see there is a bottom, which we call un. And then there are all the images going up in the tower. And the height of the tower is 2 to the n. And when you come to the top, you just return back. So you see the nth renormalization is just a rescaling of a 2 to the nth iterate. Okay. Okay, so remember when we did the circles, the big tool was how does renormalization act on these towers? So let's see how that works. Yeah, we just go, we do the same program as for the circle case. So how does renormalization act on towers? So let's see. So here we have our little map. And we have to take a U and we have to take a V. And then we have to take the return to U. Now let's say that this is actually the nth renormalization, and we have un here, and we have vn. So let's see how the corresponding tower looks like. And it is something like this. Here we have un, and we have 2 to the n layers. And now inside here, this is un. And this would be un plus 1 and vn plus 1 for the next renormalization.
So, when you swap those intervals, the final step is quadratic, right?
Yeah.
It's not a bijection.
No, it's a unimodal map. Because it's a
So you go up the towers, bijecting them until they come back?
No, so you start here.
Yes.
which is this interval,
yeah.
And there is a critical point.
Right.
And now from here to there, you get something fold. And then you just go up diffeomorphically.
Right.
And then you return. And so the first step is the fold. Okay? And so, but now let's see where we have to cut. So we have a picture of the nth renormalization, and we want to make a picture of the next renormalization. So apparently we have to take un plus 1 here, and we have to take vn plus 1, and we have to cut along this the orbit of un, and we have to cut along the orbit of vn, and then we have to paste them together. So we have here, so here we have the part, see, the first part, and here we have the part on top. And so you just take two substrips of the tower and you stack them in a different way. And so now you get the tower of length 2 to the n. And the bottom is un plus 1. And so renormalization is, again, if you look on the level of towers, you cut off pieces and you reorganize them. It's really the same as in the circle case. But in some sense, it is much simpler, because the tower is simple. It is just one building. Okay. So I think now we have all the tools to... Oh, no, one more thing. So let's start to discuss the dynamics of these maps. And as in the circle case, we get the layers of the tower, which form our Pn, which is the dynamical partition. It's exactly the same as in the circle case. But now there is a little problem that if you look at the intervals at the nth tower, the intervals are pairwise disjoint. But unfortunately, the union of all those pieces is not the whole interval. And you can see why that is true. Because when we cut off the pieces to construct the next renormalization, we forget the middle part. So you cut off some, you lose something. So, but at the same moment, it is just an interval which runs around, and then it is back. So instead of calling it the dynamical partition, we call this like Cn, which is just the same as this partition, is the aside the nth renormalization cycle. A cycle. And it are just 2 to the n intervals which are running around through the interval. So in the case of the circle diffeomorphism, it was a little bit complicated to draw the picture in the circle, where all these intervals, in the circle case, it is a little bit complicated. But in this unimodal case, it is sort of, it's easy. It's really easy, and it is just constructing a counterset. So let me make a picture for that. And so let's see. Let's first start with our interval, and let's make the first cycle. And now you know what it is. It is this interval And it is this interval. And this one goes here, and that one goes back. And so these two intervals form the first cycle. But now inside here, you are renormalizable. So inside here, there are two intervals. And there is one here, and there is one here. And they are exchanged by f to the fourth, f to the two. So that means if you take f, they will get copies here. By taking this picture, and you iterate by f, and you get it here. And now you see four intervals, and that is the second cycle. And now you know. So inside here, you will see again, because it is renormalizable, things which are exchanging under f to the 8. And this picture will be transported through the cycle. And it comes back here, and it will be back. And so, and that is your third cycle. And of course, this process continues. And in the end, you will have some set here, which is called C, and which is just the intersection of all those cycles. And of course, that is going to be a counter set. But let's make a precise statement. Let me make a precise statement about the dynamics. So a theorem. So f is infinitely renormalizable. And then let's see. Be indeed the intersection of all those cycles. And then the C is a counter set. This is not completely obvious, because you see this is exactly the same as the construction of the middle third counter set. You cut and you cut and you get two intervals, it's the same thing. But you're not sure that each time you cut off a definite piece. And so it's not like in the middle third counter set, you always cut off a third and you cut off a third. It could be that you start off to cut out less and less and less. And that these intervals, they actually stay large. And so you have to prove something that you always definitely cut off something. And that is behind this part of the theorem. And to do that, you have to do again, like you remember when we did circle diffeomorphisms, we had to prove, a key point was that the sizes of the intervals in the tower goes down to zero. And to do that, we needed nonlinearity, and we needed that the map is C2. And so in this case, we have a critical point, and that complicates things, and that's why we need C3. And so there is some analysis behind here. Not difficult analysis.
Is my failure
it's not C3? It fails in C2, probably.
It does fail.
It does fail in C2.
It's possible to find an example.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Sarma knows. I think it fails in C2. Of course, it fails in C1. But I think also in C2. Okay, another part of the statement about the dynamics is that this counter set is actually an attractor. So let me prepare that. For every n, there exists a periodic orbit. And let me call it Pn, which is contained in the nth cycle of period 2 to the n. It is just some point which follows the tower and comes back. So this is our periodic orbit. So there. And the third point, yeah. cannot find their place. So the next line should be under there, but there is not so much space. So the third point is that if you take an x which is not in all those periodic orbs, if you take a point which is not periodic, that is, x is not periodic, then the limit set of this point is exactly this counter set. So every point which is not periodic will eventually get sucked in deeper and deeper cycles. And eventually it will be running around this counter set. Yeah.
And how do you show that?
Yeah, that is the same difficulty as proving that this is a counter set. The existence is not so difficult, because you have an interval which runs around in 2 to the n steps and returns, and all those so you know the return map has a fixed point, and these are disjoint intervals, so the actual period is 2 to the n. It is sort of simple. And what will happen is, I can make a proof. You will see how it goes. So you have your point, and let's say after a couple of iterates, you get into un. Let's make a big picture. Okay, so you get into un. And now let's look at the n plus first renormalization. So what you have to do is, you have to take the second iterate on this interval. And then let me be brief, and let me not get very crazy about it. So you get something like that. And so now your point lands in somewhere here, but now this periodic point is expanding. And now you see that once, if you get in the gap, you're not in the next cycle, but now this guy is expanding, and eventually you will get in the next cycle. And so you enter a certain renormalization level, maybe in the gap, but then inside this gap is this periodic orbit which is expanding.
That's the key point, right? That the periodic orbits are all expanding.
It's expanding, yeah.
So you need to prove that.
Yeah.
And that follows.
Yeah, so this is like classical dynamics. It's sort of the people. This is not so difficult. You need some tools. You need to know what Schwarzschild derivatives are. You need to know nonlinearity things. It's not difficult, but you have to prove that. Okay. So now we have a clear picture of how the dynamics looks like. And we see in our map this counter set, and we know that this counter set is actually the attractor of the system. So the dynamics is sort of clear. So let's go and fill in the other parts of our diagram. And let's start with the easy part, the topological part. So topology. And the theorem is, it's the same as in the circle case. So if F and G are infinitely renormalizable, And so they all have these towers. They both have this counter set. Then F is topologically equivalent to G. And that means that there exists a homeomorphism. And this H of F is G of H. And so they are conjugated. And remember, in the case of the circle, our towers filled the whole circle. So the structure of the towers allowed us to build the conjugation. And so now it is a little different. Our dynamical partition, our cycles, are not filling up the whole interval. So that's a slight complication. But the proof goes true. And so for people who know kneading theory, and so it means that it says that there's a theorem by Milner and Thurston that says that if you know how the critical orbit, how the critical point jumps around, if you only know the combinatorics, then F and G are the same. And like from these cycles, you can read off how the critical orbit jumps around. And so this just follows from an old theorem by Milner and Thurston.
In the general case, of course, you don't have these pairs all the time.
In general, you might have many pairs, and the number of pairs pieces might grow. And yeah, but the tower is always simple. Okay. So we are done with the topology. So let's go to the measure theory. And so we see our orbits accumulating at this counter set. And now let's see whether there is a measure which describes the distribution of our orbits. And so the measure theory. And the theorem says that F has a unique invariant measure on our counter set. And that means that indeed, say, let's call it mu. And then if you take measurements, and that will converge to our measure. So, and you know the proof. And by just looking at the towers. And so remember that, so this, the tower is a realistic representation of the dynamics. These intervals and intervals, but we can do it more schematically by just replacing all the intervals by a dot and the maps by just a directed graph. And so what you see is you get the nth cycle, and we just represent that by a directed graph of 2 to the n points. And then there is the next cycle, and of course that is included in the previous ones. Hey, you see, you take the next one is included here, and that will be represented by again a directed graph, but now of 2 to the end points. Have you remember from when we did the circle, it was more complicated, we had 2 loops. But now the situation is very simple. So and the way this guy is included is just by winding twice around. And so now you see, if you remember, we went, this is the graph, and then we went to the measure spaces, which were just Euclidean spaces, and we see R, and we see 2, and we see R. And in the inverse limit of these measure spaces, we just see R, and that means that the object here is uniquely ergodic. So, maybe somebody was not around last week, so it might be a bit fast for that, but... You use the combinatorial structure which you get from the renormalization schemes to produce the measure, like in the circle case.
Produce the measure, but also to prove that it's that the other points converge to that measure. It's not just a standard. I mean, you also need to use, if you take a point outside, to show that the averages converge to the average.
Nah, that's okay.
Yeah, but you still need to use the specific structure, right?
I mean, if you have something which if you have a point which converges to something which is uniquely ergodic, and then what you can do is you take your point and you put point masses on the orbit, and then that measure on the piece of orbit will converge to some invariant measure on the limit. But it is only the one, there's only one. Okay? And this is the simplest situation you can imagine from a combinatorial measure theoretical point of view.
But the points outside do not converge to any specific order, is that right? It's not like in a hyperbolic case. Points in the case do not start following a specific point in the time.
Now, you know, this counter set is minimal.
Right.
Because, so, you will get, it's minimal, you will get everywhere. Every point will accumulate.
We don't have the distance between x and some point on the campus that does not go to zero. Does that not have,
yeah.
Do not have stable sets? Is that correct?
I think you do.
If you follow a specific,
I think you do. Yeah. I think you do. No, you don't. You don't. It's complicated.
You don't.
Now you do. You do. It's the same thing. Yes and no. What is the question? Yeah, I think you do. I think you do. And sort of what happens is, I'm not 100% sure. So, but if you take your point, somewhere it's sitting here, getting away from the fixed point, and it gets in the cycle. And then you just start to jump around in this cycle. And so you could take any point, and it would stay with a fixed distance to that point. But then later you get to the deeper cycle. It will start to... I think what happens is, I don't know, but I cannot really imagine. Probably if a point will get closer.
Exercise.
Hey, that's a good exercise, yeah, no. It's not so difficult, but I cannot come up with a definite answer. You had a question.
Just conjugated to an anomaly, right?
Say it again.
Here, it's conjugated to an anomaly.
Yeah. This is called an odometer. It's like the limit of cyclic groups. And if you go to other renormalization schemes, the limits will always, there will always be a counter set, and this counter set will always be the inverse limit of cyclic groups, odometers. It's true, yeah. Okay, yeah, that's good. So we are done with the measure stuff. Just a thing, this measure is simple, eh? Like, this has a quarter, this has a quarter, this has a quarter, and this has a quarter. So it's really a very simple measure. And on the next scale, this has an eighth and an eighth. So it's really the standard, the simple measure. But the proof is the same as in the circle case. So now let's go to I think it will be good. Let's go to the geometry, and that is sort of where the excitement comes. Yeah, let's call it excitement. Now you will see where the complications are. There is something going on here. So there's something called scaling ratios. And if you take the middle third counter set, then you take an interval and you cut off a third. And this third is the scaling ratio. But in our thing, we don't know how this is scaling goes. So let's see what is going on. So let's take the nth cycle, and let's take one of our intervals. There are many of them. And let's take like this one. So then there will be exactly one sitting above. So let's call this one I. And let's say this is our interval I. And it is contained in one of the higher scale. And so let's call it T of I. And then the scaling ratio of I make it a big number. It's important. It's going to be nice. It's simple. It's just the length of this I divided by something. Just how big this thing sits inside here. If you would be building the middle third counter set, this would be just a third. And now you look at the set F, of a map F, which are just all these scaling ratios when you look in the nth cycle. As you look at how these numbers tell you how the nth cycle is constructed out of the previous cycle. And so these numbers, if you know all of them, you know exactly the counter set. And now you say sigma of F is the limit of this. And so how do you write that? So you take the union of all those guys, you take the closure, and you take the, you know, so this is the limit. And so, all these numbers, this will be something between 0 and 1. And so this set, it is some subset of the unit interval. It's all the limiting scaling ratios you can observe. And this set describes like the deep structure in this counter set. This set tells you how asymptotically the construction is made. I think I repeated myself. Okay. And now there is a theorem. Let's first do an example. If you would do the middle third counter set, you can define the same numbers, and then you see that sigma n is just a third, and you see that the limiting one is also just a third. And so this set in the case of the middle third counter set, you see that it has very simple scaling structure. This means very simple scaling structure. You could call this a fractal. And wherever you look, you will see exactly the same picture. Okay. Now let's give you a thing about, let's tell you something about how this set really looks like. Theorem. And one thing is that the set of scaling ratios is exactly the same as the set of scaling ratios for the renormalization fixed point. R of F star is F star. And so what the way our counter set is constructed in an asymptotic scale is exactly the same as the counter set of the renormalization. So F is infinite renormalizable. And so our F is infinite renormalizable. You know, let's make a picture. Here we have our fixed point, and here we have the stable manifold, and our F is somewhere here, and you know that these are the infinite renormalizable maps. And so our F is infinite renormalizable. We get an asymptotic scaling numbers, and that is exactly the same as the scaling structure of the renormalization fixed point. And of course, that has something to do that renormalization converts there. And renormalization, remember, is zooming in. Only at one place. But at least there should be something here which is inside there. But actually, they are the same. So the asymptotic scaling structure of the attractor of an infinitely renormalizable map is exactly the same as the scaling structure of the fixed point. So and now the sort of the mystery comes.
Stable manifold of F star.
Yeah.
So even though they might have different combinatorials.
No. We are only doing period doubling renormalization. And remember.
So you're only looking at all of this is under the assumption that you always have just two triggers.
And we never talked about any other renormalization than period doubling. Everything is period doubling.
So this is not true, they have different...
Then it is not true. No. It's not true. Okay? So the fun part, of sort of the fascinating part, is that this thing itself is a counter set. And so it is completely opposite to how you make the middle third counter set. And so in the middle third counter set, you do everywhere the same. And this counter set, there is actually no two places where you do exactly the same. So the scaling structure, the way you build this counter set, is highly, it is extremely rich. Wherever you do something, you have to do it according to that spot. If you zoom in somewhere here, you scale in a very different way. And you can distinguish two places by looking how you are zooming in. This is a counter set. So it is an extremely rich scaling structure. So, and this is what you observe, that people measure in nature. And so you can imagine that a middle third counter set you can make with your hands. It's always a third. But if on each scale you have different numbers, you will never be able to do that by hand. But nature does it like that. So, okay, a consequence of this and you will not be surprised. Maybe that could be an exercise. And so if F and G are infinitely renormalizable. And then you know that F is topologically conjugated to G. And now if you look at the restriction of the conjugation to the counter set of F to the counter set of G, then this thing is differentiable. So we see rigidity again. And you can imagine if these two counter sets have the same way, if they are made the same way on an asymptotic scale, then you will see a fine relations between F and G. And so if you know this, you can prove this. Okay, so let's continue tomorrow, and then we start to discuss Hannon dynamics. So the last 2 days will be Hannon dynamics, and it will be mainly discussing the phenomena. So sort of like today, it will be difficult to squeeze out exercises. Things will get quickly complicated. So let's keep this as an exercise for this afternoon. So, bye.